Author Donna Jodhan presents
A Present from Prince Charming. He had been the darling of his social circle. The girls liked him because of his charming ways, hence the name bestowed on him. The boys liked him too because he was also good to them. In short, he lavished gifts on all of his friends. Then one day, something happened to the prince, and things changed drastically. Secret double lives came into existence, and other lives were greatly affected. It would all eventually lead to tragedy. Deceit and payback pack this drama.
Hello, 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 it's Detective DJ, and I'm back with another episode for you. Exciting, thrilling, lots of intrigue, lots of nooks and crannies for you to look in if you're wanting to solve this mystery. And you know what? I'm happy to be here with you, and I hope you're having a great day. Hope you have been having a great week, and thank you again for listening in. Well, let me introduce my team again, because, you know, I like to do this so that we don't forget about our team. Dr. Jay Harrington, our resident psychologist. Chip Sanderson, our resident investigator and my right-hand person. Dr. Nicholas Gasquet, our resident pathologist. Dr. Ryan Martini, our crime scene specialist. And, of course, Alex Kirchhoff, our resident guru, whiz kid, and everything you want to know about the computer, ask good old Alex and he'll tell you all about it. So, today we have a great episode for you called A Present from Prince Charming. And I know that you have already heard the description to this. So without much ado, we're going to dive right into this so that I don't lose you along the way. And let's see if you can figure out who done it for this episode. Okay? So, onwards. Winter seems to have come early in this part of the world. And in the cozy living room, a fire has been lit in the fireplace, and a young pregnant lady is sitting down and she's knitting a baby blanket. It is an ivory-colored blanket, very pretty. And in another home just down the street, two small twin girls are sitting on the floor of their gaily decorated room. And they're playing happily with a huge doll's house. While on a deserted beach at the foot of the street, a young man stands with his hands buried deep in his pockets, and he is staring blankly out to sea. This is a scene moments before this crime takes place. And we're going to go to the scene of the crime, and Ryan Martini, Dr. Ryan, is going to describe it to us here. He tells us that the police has been called to the rectory of Reverend William Goodell. His housekeeper had summoned them there after coming home to discover that the Reverend's body was in the study of the rectory. Two empty coffee cups stand on the Reverend's desk, along with a half-full plate of cookies. The office is extremely neat and tidy, and nothing seems to have been touched. The Reverend's desk is also very neat. The phone stands at the top left-hand corner of the desk. An IBM ThinkPad computer sits in the middle of the desk, and neat piles of folders, booklets, and scratch pads are arranged in some semblance of order around the desk. Bookshelves line two walls of the study, while on the third wall, family photos prevail. The Reverend's wife and his son. His wife's name is Megan, and his son's name is Liam. There are bay windows to the left of the desk, and they look out onto a pretty little rose garden. The Reverend's lifeless body is in his chair, and his head is leaning backwards. So picture this. His lifeless body is in the chair that is at his desk, or in his desk chair, and his head is tilted backwards. The Reverend's housekeeper is standing outside of the study, and she's holding on to the collar of a huge golden retriever. She's sobbing quietly, and the dog is whining. She's trying desperately to comfort the dog. Well, Dr. Shea at this stage always has something to add to this, and these are strictly her opinions. She's saying that the killer did this because he wanted it carried out at the victim's home. She's also saying that the perfect occasion for this to have taken place was that it took place over a cup of coffee. And she says that William's reason for having been there, or the Reverend's reason for having been there, is that the time of the day when he normally met his parishioners. Strong theory. Well, let's go on and see what else my team has to tell me. According to Chip, the motives for the crime, a possible payback, maybe a settling of accounts, a crime of passion, or what else could it be? And according to Dr. Shea, she has a profile for the suspect. And let's see what she has to say. The Reverend and the suspect probably knew each other very well. The suspect seems to have planned the murder in advance, and they carefully chose the time to commit the crime, when no one would be around. The Reverend had had no reason to suspect his visitor's motives on that fateful day. Well, we're going to go straight to the investigation because this is really bothering me. Who'd want to kill a reverend? Reverend William Goodell had been working in a little seaside parish for the last 6 years. And he had seemed to be very happy being there. He was very hardworking, and his flock had all loved him. His bishop had also loved him. And Reverend Will, as he had been affectionately called, had been best known for putting on those wonderful church plays, especially so at Christmas time. The parishioners had grown used to have their beloved Reverend spend 3 days every week away from their parish. If anyone had asked, Reverend Will would say, with a smile, he had to be away because of church business. This is how the bishop had wished it to be, and no one had ever questioned it. Reverend Will had had a lovely wife named Megan, and a darling little boy named Liam. In a small town not too far away, lived a man of a similar age to that of the Reverend. and his name was William Tremont. William Tremont had been a jeweler, and every week he would travel out of town for a few days to sell his jewelry and to buy jewel pieces for his shop. William Tremont had been married with a little girl named Era, and his wife Meredith and Era had meant the world to this jeweler. His trust customers had called him Trusty Will. Trusty Will Tremont. The Reverend and the jeweler had shared something very special in common. A very hidden past. They had been both very familiar with a young man of many years ago. A young man who had lived in a mid-sized city about 500 miles from where they were both living at the present time. Before disappearing one evening, this young man had been the darling of his social circle. He had come from very rich parents, and he was an only child. His name was Liam Gareth Teeman. Liam had been bright and popular, kind and considerate, generous and thoughtful. Folks had called him Prince Charming because this is who he really was. Lots of presents for his girlfriends and favors for his boyfriends. There was one thing, however, that had greatly troubled his parents, and that was that Liam was terribly naive at times. One night, shortly after classes had ended for the year, Liam had gone partying with his friends, and before he knew it, he and his friends had drunk a bit too much. And then a friend had asked to borrow Liam's brand new Mercedes, and he had willingly loaned it to his friend with no questions asked. The car had been a recent birthday present to Liam from his parents. An hour later, the cops were looking for Liam, but he had seemed to disappear into thin air. The dead body of a young female had been found in the passenger seat of Liam's Mercedes. She had been strangled to death, and witnesses had said that they had seen Liam arguing with the dead girl not too long before his Mercedes with the dead body had been found. A small gift wrap present had been found at the edge of the passenger seat with a written note that read, "From Prince Charming, with all my love." The small package had contained a tiny jewel box, and inside of it was an exquisite gold band with a diamond, and it was an engagement ring. It was believed that Liam had designed it himself, as at the time he had been apprenticing at his family's thriving jewelry business, and it was expected that upon graduation, Liam would join his family's business. The girl's name was Summer Stone, and she had been Liam's girlfriend at that time. Liam's family and friends had all refused to believe that Liam had killed Summer. They had believed that he had loved her too much to have killed her. However, there were a few who had believed that he may have done it out of passion and jealousy, because Summer had recently begun to date someone else. Liam's parents had spent thousands of dollars searching for their beloved son, but alas, without any success. both Reverend Goodell and the jeweler knew exactly where to find Liam Gareth Teeman. But for reasons known only to each of them, they had vowed never to tell. There was someone who had wanted the Reverend dead because of Bigamy. There was someone else who had wanted him dead because he had deceived them. And there was another who had yet wanted him dead because of the incident with Liam Gareth Teeman. Whoa. Where are we headed with this, folks? William Goodell, the Reverend. William Tremont, the jeweler. William Gareth Teeman, the young man. Prince Charming. Let's move on. Let's look at the suspects. According to Chip, Megan Goodell, the Reverend's wife. Meredith Tremont, wife of William Tremont. Troy Manson, the Reverend's childhood friend. According to Dr. Nick Gasquet, he says that the cause of death was as follows. Reverend William Goodell was poisoned by strychnine, placed in the cookies that he had eaten. Death had been quick, but it was also painful. His body had been found about an hour after his death. Well, according to Dr. Nick Gasquet, he says how it could have been done is as follows. This crime could have been committed using a very simple method. First, the killer had decided upon a method, which was death by poisoning. Next, they chose how they would do it, using cookies to do so. They more than likely knew what the Reverend's favorite cookies were, and then they had chosen their time to do it, when no one would be around, during coffee time at the rectory, when the housekeeper was out and when everybody else was away. Now let's look at the summary and hints, okay? So we have a crime scene of Reverend William Goodell, Reverend Will, as he was lovingly known, found by his housekeeper in his chair at his desk in his study. Head tilted back, the office is neat and tidy, does not seem to have been disturbed, and the housekeeper is standing at the door trying to hold back the dog from going in. She's sobbing and the dog is whining. So the victim has been poisoned in his office, and he was poisoned because he was all alone. The killer had no difficulty in having access to him. And the reason being, it could have been anything from settling of accounts, payback, blackmail, you name it, it could have been it. Profile of suspect. The Reverend and the suspect knew each other very well. The suspect seemed to have planned the murder in advance. They carefully chose a time to commit the murder when no one would be around, everyone would be out. And the Reverend had no reason to have suspected the visitor's motives, right, on that very fateful day, because they both knew each other. And the suspects, Megan Goodell, the Reverend's wife, Meredith Tremont, wife of William Tremont, and Troy Manson, the Reverend's childhood friend. Now, Alex has some important questions for you to consider when you go to try and put the pieces together to solve this crime. It's not a Humpty Dumpty thing here. Let's just see what Alex has to tell us. Which of the three suspects could have had the strongest motive? Which one could have accused the Reverend of bigamy? Which one could have accused him of deceit? Who could have wanted him dead? Because of the incident with Liam Gareth Teeman. Could there have been an important link between the Reverend, the jeweler, and Liam Gareth Tiemann? Why were the Reverend and the jeweler not willing to disclose Liam's past? Could Liam's past have played a part in the Reverend's murder? This is confusing. All right. Let me go back to the description. Maybe this will help you out. He had been the darling of his social circle. The girls had liked him because of his charming ways, hence the name bestowed on him, Prince Charming. The boys had liked him too because he had also been very good to them. In short, he had lavished gifts on all of his friends. Then, one day, something had happened to the prince, and things had changed drastically. Secret double lives had come into existence, and other lives were greatly affected. It would all eventually lead to tragedy. Deceit and payback packed this drama. You know the crime scene? You know the suspects? Megan Goodell, who was the Reverend's wife, Meredith Tremont, wife of the jeweler, William Tremont, and Troy Manson, the Reverend's childhood friend. You know the important questions that Alex has presented you with? Which of the three suspects could have had the strongest motive? Which one could have accused the Reverend of bigamy? Which one could have accused him of deceit? Who could have wanted him dead? Because of the incident with Liam Gareth Tiemann, could there have been an important link between the Reverend, the jeweler, and Liam Gareth Tiemann? And why were the Reverend and the jeweler not willing to disclose Liam's past? Could Liam's past have played a part in the Reverend's murder? Lots for you to think about, folks. Now, we're going to move on to the gathering of the evidence. And Dr. Ryan is submitting a report of the gathering of additional evidence. The police had established a firm link between the Reverend, the jeweler, and young Liam Gareth Tiemann. They had also established a firm link between the jeweler's wife, Meredith, and the Reverend, and Liam's childhood friend, Troy Manson. He had been searching for Liam Gareth Tiemann for years, and he had recently made a shocking discovery that had left him shaken and angry. And witnesses had confirmed that Troy had even spoken to both Megan and Meredith, wives of the Reverend and the jeweler, respectively. The ladies had also confirmed this. Well, Tremont had disappeared around the same time that the Reverend had been killed. I don't know what's going on, folks, but maybe you can help us out. More about the suspects. Megan Goodell had been married to the Reverend for more than 6 years, and they had had a little boy called Liam. The marriage had been a very happy one, and up until recently, Megan had enjoyed being the wife of the Reverend. She had loved to help him put on his church plays, especially those at Christmas time. But recently, things had begun to change, and parishioners had begun to notice. First, Megan had been seen to become very withdrawn, and this had turned to much more. A drastic change in personality, and especially a change towards her husband. From outgoing and gregarious to being extremely withdrawn and depressed. Meredith Tremont had been married to her husband Will Tremont for a similar length of time, 6 years. And up until now, their marriage had seemed to be a very happy one. She and Will had settled in a small town not too far from where the Reverend and his family had lived. Will Tremont the jeweler and his wife Meredith had a little daughter called Era, and they had seemed to be the perfect family. That is until recently, when something drastic had seemed to have happened. It seemed that overnight Meredith had changed. From the smiling and soft-spoken wife of a kindly jeweler into a very depressed and withdrawn wife. Troy Manson had been a very close childhood friend of Liam Gareth Tiemann. And before he had suddenly disappeared, Liam had been dating one of Troy's cousins, Summer Stone. When Liam had disappeared, Troy was one of the very few who had believed that Liam had murdered his beloved cousin. And he had vowed to himself that one day he would find Liam and bring him to justice. Troy had spent almost a decade looking for Liam, and he had searched far and wide across the country, using his family's financial backing to help him do so, along with his talents as a reporter. He had spent a significant amount of time and resources in his efforts, but one day he had unexpectedly hit pay dirt. A write-up in a newspaper and a photo of a smiling Will Goodell was all that he needed. Troy Manson was convinced that the goodly Reverend Will Goodell would help him to put the pieces together, and he had set out on a firm mission to solve the childhood mystery. He had been determined once and for all to solve a cold crime. But what he had discovered had greatly shocked and angered him. According to Alex, we're going to look at the murder through the eyes of the killer. The killer had known exactly what they had to do. They had carefully chosen the time and the method, and when it would be done. They had determined that the best way for them to have gained access to the goodly reverend would be at coffee time at the rectory, a time that had been set aside on certain days by the reverend to have coffee with those parishioners who had wanted to talk with him. The killer had known that Reverend Will loved orange-flavored cookies and had decided to use these cookies to conceal the poison. The rest had been very, very easy. The arrest. It was a somewhat very chilly spring day when the cops had come for the suspect. There was a fresh but biting wind blowing, and the flowers had just begun to bloom. The birds were already out and about, and a typical spring sunshine was shining. Somehow, the arrestee was not really surprised when the cops had come for them. And they had gone quietly with head in hands. Well, can you guess who was arrested? Was it Megan, the Reverend's wife, who had changed from outgoing and gregarious to being depressed and withdrawn? Or Meredith, the jeweler's wife, who had changed from smiling and soft-spoken to being depressed and withdrawn? Or was it Troy Manson, who had become extremely angry at what he had discovered? Well, let's go to court. And on this particular day, the court was packed with parishioners, along with friends and a few curious spectators. Several family members of the suspect were also in attendance, and they were seated in the front row of the courtroom. There's also some local media as well. The prosecution had offered a very simple and straightforward case. A charge of first-degree murder on premeditation with an intent to kill. And they had presented the following case. The killer had used his knowledge of the Reverend's, or used their knowledge of the Reverend's whereabouts to plan their crime. First, they had chosen a time to visit the rectory based on coffee time hour, when the Reverend used to meet with his parishioners. And after getting an appointment to see the Reverend, they had prepared his favorite cookies and had laced them with strychnine. On the day of the crime, they had taken their cookies with them to the rectory. And from there on, it was relatively easy. The Reverend had brought out the coffee cups, and the killer had supplied the cookies. An unsuspecting Reverend had bitten into the cookies, and the deed had been done. No one had been around to witness anything, and the killer knew that the housekeeper would return shortly, as it had been her custom to run errands while the Reverend was engaged in coffee time with his parishioners. But in their defense, the defendant had pleaded temporary insanity and said that it had been a crime of passion. After they had discovered something very, very unsuspecting. And it was devastating. And it was devastating about the Reverend and what he had done in his past. Something so devastating that it had directly affected their life. An unforgivable and an illegal action on the part of the Reverend. The defense lawyer had asked the jury to consider a charge of either second degree murder, manslaughter, based on the mental state of their defendant. But the prosecution had stuck to their charge of first degree murder, based on premeditation. Prosecution wanted the suspect found guilty on first degree murder. Defendant pleaded for manslaughter based on a special defense. My goodness. Now, in the minds of the jury had to consider whether or not this was premeditated murder or a crime based on severe mental stress or even a crime of passion triggered by horrendous deceit. Was the crime triggered by something specific? And if so, was it a trigger that was a momentary one? Or at the spur of the moment? If not, would this mean a verdict of first-degree murder? So let me just clarify again. The jury had to consider whether this was first-degree murder based on premeditation, or could it be second-degree murder based on a loss of self-control or diminished responsibility, which were special defenses, and if these defenses were to be pleaded successfully, then the defendant would be entitled to be found guilty of manslaughter, voluntary manslaughter. All very confusing, but you know what? We'll see what happens. Let's go on. Now, outside the court, and then again, there were very few who had had no sympathy at all for the suspect. On the whole, confusion had reigned supreme among the crowd outside of the courtroom. My goodness, even I am confused. Well, Chip took a straw poll and handed this over to me. Guilty or not guilty? A crime had taken place? But first degree murder or what? I think there was no clear winner in this straw poll. It was almost 50-50. Alright? The verdict came down a little while, about a few hours after the jury had retired. The defendant had been found guilty of first-degree murder based on premeditation. Identification of the real killer? Mrs. Megan Goodell had been found guilty of the crime, but she had appealed the verdict on the grounds of temporary insanity, and her sentence had been reduced to a much lighter one. The true story of the tragedy of Reverend William Goodell follows. Reverend William Goodell, William Tremont the jeweler, and Liam Tiemann all had one thing in common. They were the same person. And how and why? On that fateful night when Liam's girlfriend, Summer Stone, had been found in the passenger seat of his brand new Mercedes, it was not Liam who had murdered her. Yes, Liam had been seen arguing with her before she had been murdered. But at the end of the argument, he had asked her to meet him at his car, and she had agreed and had gone there. She had opened the door to the passenger seat and had gotten in. But someone else and not Liam had been waiting for her. It was the killer, and he had strangled her to death. She had never seen the present that had been left for her by Liam. And it was Liam who had designed the ring contained in the package. When Liam had arrived at his car, not too long after Summer Stone had been killed, he had panicked on seeing her dead. And, without too much thought, he had fled. But, before fleeing for good, he had returned unseen to his home. He had done so to retrieve some cash that he had always kept in hand for emergencies. Liam Gareth Tiemann had been devastated, and now he was on the run. He had traveled out of town, and he had hitchhiked in order to get out of town. And after a few days far enough away, he had come up with a plan. he had sought refuge in a church, and from there, his plan had taken on a shape and life of its own. Liam had changed his name to Will Goodell, and he had made fast friends with the minister, who had encouraged him to become a reverend. Upon graduation, he had been given his own small town parish, and it was there that he had met Megan, and they were quickly married. His son Liam had been born shortly after they were married. But Liam, the reverend, now called Will Goodell, had shared his past with no one because he was afraid of being discovered. Shortly after his marriage to Megan, he had to go out of town on church business for a few months. And here is where he had made a grave error. While on business away from home, he had met Meredith and had fallen deeply in love with her. And not being able to help himself, he had assumed the name of Will Tremont, passing himself off as a jeweler, and had married her knowing full well that he was committing bigamy. They had settled in a small town not too far from where he had been stationed as a reverend. And soon after his marriage, Meredith had had a little girl. Her name was Era. Liam Tiemann, the young man on the run, had now assumed his second identity, Reverend Will Goodell, and now Will Tremont the jeweler. Daughter Era was born not too long after his marriage to Meredith, and now Liam was forced to live two separate lives. Lives that he had somehow managed to juggle until one day when Troy Manson had read about the ever-growing popularity of the Christmas plays that were being put on by Reverend Will Goodell and his lovely wife Megan. Troy Manson had immediately spotted the Reverend's resemblance to a younger Liam of several years ago, and soon he was on the hunt for the truth. Troy had been a very enterprising reporter and had no difficulty putting the pieces together. He had enlisted assistance from some of his reporter friends, and this had made his task much easier. Troy had always felt that somehow that Liam may have been guilty, and he was determined to uncover the truth, because Summer had been his beloved cousin, and he had wanted justice for her death. He had told his story to Megan and Meredith, and the rest is history. It was Megan who had decided to take action. She had baked the cookies, and on that fateful day, she had told her husband that there were no appointments for the coffee time hour. She had suggested that they have coffee together during the coffee time hour, and she had sent the housekeeper on her errands as always. The rest, as they say, is history. I'm Detective DJ, and I hope you've enjoyed this particular episode as much as I have enjoyed bringing it to you. I hope to see you again sometime very soon with another episode. But in the meantime, have yourselves a wonderful, wonderful day and a great week. Take care of yourselves, and bye for now.